Children's are the gift from the God. They are the future of the nation. You as a teacher have the great responsibility to promote their development and protect their rights. They are very precious, special, these little ones. Today, in this video, we'll discuss how to protect the rights of children, and you as a teacher, what would be your role in protecting their rights. With me, we have another expert, Dr. Elizabeth from the School of Education, Indira Gandhi National Open University, New Delhi. As you know, there are several factors that promote child's growth. Very important is the protection of their rights. They need support from the parents. They need positive social environment. And more important is quality education. And you as a teacher, I think, have several roles to play here. So that can really promote the growth of our children, the future of our country. What our children need? They need good education. It is the right to education. Every one of us has the right to education. And these little ones also. What they need from the school? They need an environment, a safe environment, where safely they can learn, they can play together, they can opportunity to have fun. We have to preserve their childhood. I'd like to request Dr. Elizabeth to discuss and light on Right to Children to Free and Compulsory Education Act, RT Act, how this RT Act has a provision to protect the rights. Dr. Elizabeth.
Thank you. So Professor Amitav has stated how, what all things the children need in a school, the safe environment, and how the teachers have to take care of that. So here we can see there are several acts passed, but the most important act is the Right to Education Act. When we state it as Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education, let me see how the rights are ensured in this Right to Education Act 2009. When we go to the first provision, we can see that every child at the age between 6 to 14 years of age, they shall have the right for free and compulsory education. And here I want to stress the free and compulsory. What is the term free means? Here, free means that no child has to pay any fees or they incur any expense while pursuing elementary education.
That's why free.
Yeah, yes. That's the term free means. And the next term, that is compulsory education. Here compulsory education means that it casts the local authorities and the government to ensure admission, retention, and no child is dropping out of the elementary education. So this is the two important terms in free and compulsory education. And here we can see the first provision itself. It is stating about that the admission can be taken in a neighborhood school. And the neighborhood school, when we think of that, that term itself connotes two senses. The first sense we can see is that the neighborhood school, normally we may think that it is within the walkable distance of the child's residence. the primary school or the upper primary school. But the most important sense is that the neighborhood school is considered as a common place for education where it cut across caste, class, gender, disability. All the children learn together in the best inclusive manner.
Yes.
And the next provision we can see that the age appropriate admission. Mostly this age appropriate admission, why it is stressed is that some children may drop out after taking admission. And for such children, when they want to continue their education, normally they should be admitted according to their age. The objective is to avoid fear and embarrassment in the mind of the students that they are going to sit with younger children like that. So the older children should not feel that embarrassment in the mind. And the next provision is that no child in the age between 6 to 14 years of age denied admission due to lack of any document. And when we look at that, mostly the transfer certificate, without that, the admission will not take place.
Yes.
But now, delaying of transfer certificate may not be a reason for denying admission of children. So this is the three provisions.
This is the provisions will protect their rights education. For definitely.
Yeah. And the next provision we can see that
yes.
all children have equal right to education.
Yes.
Here all children emphasizes whether
means
the children.
All children.
Yeah,
yes.
means all children. Here the all children includes the
children
migrant
with,
children or the children with a disability or any type disadvantaged children.
Yes.
They need equal rights to continuing their education.
Yes.
And the next provision we can see that no child can be failed or expelled from the school. We cannot deny due
Correct.
To lack of any document
yes.
or any reason. And the next provision states that this act prohibits physical punishment, mental harassment and corporal punishment to children.
Very important factor.
And here we can see that this corporal punishment, mostly in the teacher's mind or the educationist, they are telling that this corporal punishment is not a means to create discipline in the classroom. It is
True.
Not the means to create discipline. And to ensure the rights of children, we know that there are important statutory bodies,
True.
The commissions, the NCPCR and the SCPCR.
That chapter 6 of the RT Act states.
RT Act yes. states about that. It ensures the protection of rights of children.
Yes.
And here in National Commission for Protection of Child Rights, they are discussing about the POSCO Act 2012.
True.
That is the protection of childs from sexual offences.
Yes, we have at national level the commission,
state level,
and you talk about the POSCO Act.
POSCO Act. So the sexual harassment or assault or any type of discrimination. So we can see that there are commissions to protect the rights of the child. And when we see the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the
of
Child,
the children.
How they describe the child rights, they states that everyone should recognize all students' rights to develop physically, mentally, and socially to their
fullest potential. That's great.
To express their opinion and to participate in decision affecting
their future.
So three things is there. The physical, mental protection should be given. And the expression, freedom
is,
of expression.
That is the United Nations CRC.
CRCs. They
Correct.
Are telling about
yes.
that. And we may say that the children must not have a voice in their own aspects. But we should give a voice to children to develop in their own aspects. Sometimes physical or social, political, in that aspects may some voice we should
And we
give.
Talk also about the child right, different kind of child rights.
Yes, yes. There are fundamental rights.
True.
When we see these child rights, first we have to know what are the fundamental rights of a child. Regarding the fundamental rights, the first right that is right to survival And here the survival means the right to get good food, nutritious food, and water and sanitation. Everything is there. And the next one, that is right to development. That development, it occurs when a child gets education. The formal education is important.
Yes.
And more than that, besides education, there should be that right to leisure and recreation
yes.
also. Because without denying this recreation and recreation and leisure, how they will develop? Their fullest development we mean.
Yes.
And the next right, that is right to protection. That protection from sexual abuse or discrimination, like that. So many abuses are taking place in the case of children. And the next one, that is right to participate.
Right to participate.
So
it's very important, this right.
Yeah. And then this right to participation.
They should not be discriminated in their participation.
In their participation. Whether it is in the classroom activities or in outside activities when they take decisions.
Yes.
They need, the participation of the children is very important.
Very
this
important.
Is all about the fundamental rights of children.
Yes.
So this is the context where the relevance of child rights is coming about. So here comes, now we have to think on, discuss on the child protection.
Very what important. And this is a very important role of
role
the teacher.
Of teachers, yeah.
Child because protection. After the home, the school is the second home. You can say it's a very important place where the child spends a lot of time.
So here the child protection, it refers to protection from violence, exploitation, abuse
and neglect.
Now, I hand it over to Professor Amitav to carry on, to discuss more on child protection.
It's more important how to linkage school along with the protection of rights of children. You know, the school is a place where children should feel free to communicate whenever they are in trouble. The teachers would be able to recognize the abuse and respond to it in a right way.
And mostly,
and it in a sensitive manner. It's very important. When there's an abuse, how to respond in a sensitive manner is very important. So here we want, there's a linkage between school and the protection of rights of children. Coming to the role of school, you can appreciate that how school is important. It provides safe place for learning and play. Reaches out to all children without discrimination. Provides psychological protection. Gives children an identity as a student. That's very important. And most important is the protect children from diverse needs from discrimination. Like what you mentioned. Children with a disability, children, those are, working migrant children. There are many children come from different background. So, the school plays a very important role in protecting the rights. So, what dangers we can see in the school where teacher, you know, can be important. Even sometimes teacher also pose danger to the children and the people. We can understand
that
So, number one is physical abuse, as in corporal punishment that you have already spelled out. Sexual abuse by teachers or others that can happen in the school. Bullying by teachers or other students.
That
bullying
is
very common.
Very common in the classroom.
It has to be. It has to be stopped.
Bullying.
Emotional abuse by teachers and other students. And you, as a teacher, you have to stop it. You have to protect their rights. There are many types of abuse, as you have understood. This is a physical abuse, emotional or psychological abuse, sexual abuse, and it's not abuse, it's a neglect.
Neglect
is also very important because we have to protect the children from any kind of neglect.
So I would like to add, in the case of that neglect, we can see that some students may not give any voice in the class, neglecting their expressions. And mostly in the physical abuse, we can see that the teachers may be asking students to stand up for a long time or stand at the back. So this type of physical abuse,
even the classmates can cause physical abuse. There can be many. Here the more important what we are going to discuss in this video is the role of teachers. Teachers have four roles, very four important roles. Number one is identifying abuse. Responding to abuse.
Yes.
If there is some abuse in the student, how the teacher should respond to it.
That is important.
Reporting of abuse.
Yes.
How the abuse should be reported. To whom it should be reported. Because we have different act, different law. Yes. We have the procedure, police,
yes.
Then higher authorities, a different thing there. Then preventing abuse.
Yes.
We should create such an environment in the school that can prevent abuse. That's very important also. So where teachers have a great role to play. Let us talk about emotional abuse.
So how to identify emotional abuse?
If a child has undergone some kind of emotional abuse, you can check these kind of things. There can be sudden speech problem.
Yes.
There can be self-depreciation showing lack of self-worth,
yes.
That I am nothing. Overreaction to mistakes.
Yes.
Extreme fear of new situation.
Yes.
Chronic running away. They want to run away from the school, even run away from the home. Inappropriate response to pain.
Yes.
They don't feel like there is any pain. They can stand under the sun for hours.
Hours, yeah.
And extreme of passivity or aggression.
Aggression.
If you as a teacher, if you observe these kind of signs in the students, you can think, is your child has been to some kind of emotional abuse? You have a great role to play. Other abuses are like physical abuse.
Yes.
Unexplained injuries to bones or bites that you can see in the child's body. Unlikely excuses for injuries, chronic running away, self-destructive tendencies, aggression towards others, distrust of adults, and fear of physical contact, shrinking back if touched. Dr. Elizabeth,
yes.
These kind of signs a teacher can observe.
But there needs a close and a good rapport between the learners. A teacher should develop that one and observe the
students. That's why teachers should be friendly.
Friendly, yeah, that is important.
You know, the teacher should, love the child and children should love the teacher. That relationship will help to identify these kind of symptoms. You should be a friendly teacher. So physical abuse is very important. Besides physical abuse, you have to worry a lot on sexual abuse.
Yes.
Sexual abuse is something which is very serious in nature.
Yes, yes.
And that can happen in the school. And there are number of symptoms, number of signs you can identify whether your student is undergoing any kind of sexual abuse. There can be extreme reaction, such as depression, self-mutilation. These are very important signs.
Yes.
Or attempt for suicide or running away. Or the sudden loss of appetite or compulsive eating. Child start eating more and more.
Mm-hmm.
Being isolated or withdrawn.
It can be seen in the classroom.
Yes. Inability to concentrate.
Yes.
You can find the child is not, your student not concentrating.
Just the...
Is distracted.
Yeah,
yes.
Distracted.
Yes.
Attention.
Yes, Dr. Elizabeth. Yes. Lack of trust or fear of someone they know.
Yeah.
They don't trust. You can see they're very fearful. So these symptoms a teacher can observe and they should establish contact with the student.
Yes.
You know, you have to have a rapport to know what is happening with the student.
Student.
Whether it is happening in the school or teacher also should responsible or should sensitive if it is happening outside school also.
And one more thing I would like to add is that the children should feel free to approach the teacher and share their grievances and their complaints.
Yes. And other aspect, as we have said, it is neglect.
Yeah.
Neglect is, you can say, some kind of, we should not call it abuse, but neglect is a condition.
Yes.
That, you know, doesn't help child to enjoy all the rights.
Rights, yes.
And if you want to protect the rights, then you have to stop the neglect. You have to prevent the child from any neglect.
Yes.
Neglect can be, you can, there are number of signs you can find out whether child is neglected or not. Like frequent hunger, stealing or hiding food.
Yes.
Poor personal hygiene.
Yeah.
Constant tiredness. Poor clothing. Untreated medical problems.
Okay. Sometimes that
yes.
medical.
Yes.
Medication is continuing.
No, no, that means okay. If the parents are not serious.
Serious, yeah.
Naturally, they are not treating, they are not consulting the doctor. They are not taking child to any doctor. So, their medical problem is untreated.
Untreated, yes.
So, this is some kind of neglect on the part of the parents also. And severe neglect can lead to no social relationship.
Isolated. They are
withdrawn.
Okay.
Children are, you can find children withdrawn.
Yeah.
So these are abuses. The teachers were expect that teachers should identify.
Yes.
This abuse can happen in the school. This abuse can happen in the outside, in the home or outside the school. So as a teacher, you have the role to identify the abuse.
Yes.
And more important is how to respond to those abuses.
How a teacher should
respond. Yes. If suppose you could find out, you found that some children have abuses. So how to respond to that? So all reactions, all actions taken to respond to abuse should be consistent with the principle of that. The child, you have to take care of the child's best interest when you want to respond to it. Whatever actions are taken, it is essential to remember that an insensitive or inappropriate intervention can serve to further victimize and unnecessarily harm the child.
Yes, surely it will.
You have to take full action.
Yeah.
You have to stand with the child till you have responded well to the child abuse.
Yes.
So once you decide, you have to be with the child. Very important. Very
and
important.
Professor Amitav has stated rightly, because these abuses may lead to this low self-esteem in the mind of the child, and it later on it will affect their future development.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Important. Once the teacher has identified abuse, now teacher has to respond.
Yeah.
What teacher to respond means what teachers should do. So whatever action the teacher takes, it should not victimize the child.
Yes.
It should not harm the child further. It has to be in a sensitive manner. It has to be in a manner, you have to cool, calm the child, and strategically the teacher has to take the steps here.
Steps, yes.
The two components, how the teacher should respond to the situation of child abuse. Number one, ensuring that child's immediate needs are being met and they are safe from further harm in a comforting environment.
Yes, that is very important. Comforting environment.
Environment. And there is no further harm to the child. Secondly, as a teacher, you have to ensure that the matter is not sidelined but reported in the appropriate manner in the best interest of the child.
That is very important.
Very important. In the best interest of the child. This aspect, the teacher have to really take care. And what more a teacher can do? Because teacher is a mentor. Teacher is a friend to the student. So here, if you have identified the abuse, you wanted to respond it appropriately. So as a teacher, the first step is to ensure that the child is safe from harm and is in a protected environment.
Yeah. That comfort environment is very important.
If a child discloses to you that she or he is being or was abused, it is important to respond in a calm, caring and supportive manner.
So, Professor Amitav, I want to stress that supportive environment.
Yes.
Mostly this supportive environment children may not be getting. So, this creating the supportive environment is very important.
Teacher have to create. And more important, how to talk to the child. When the child is reporting an abuse, how to talk? Number one, the teacher have to stay calm and be reassuring.
Yes. reassuring is important.
That child is not guilty. Child is has not done any crime or anything being abused. Stay calm and reassuring. Find a quiet place to talk.
Yeah, keeping away. That secrecy is very important.
Yes. Believe in what you are being told. Listen, but do not press the child for information.
Yes, that is important.
That's very important, how to talk to the child. Say that you are glad that the child has told you.
Yes.
Say that you will do your best to protect and support the child. If necessary, seek medical help and contact the police as soon as possible.
So that is the extreme step.
Not extreme, because teacher has to respond to this.
This, okay.
There are certain difficulties.
Difficulties.
But as a teacher, you have to step in. You have to step in. Then very important.
Yeah.
All our teachers should know there is a procedure of reporting the abuse.
The child line number.
Child line number. That is 1098. Please remember.
Yeah.
1098 is the child line number. You should also tell your students also to keep this number intact with them. It's very important. So, fourth important duty of the teacher is prevent the abuse.
Yes.
Make the school such an environment where the abuse should not take place. So prevention is better than cure. How a teacher can prevent the abuse? Number one, upholding the teacher's code and conduct is the one way of preventing abuse.
Okay.
You should be a model for the child. You are a model for the role model for all the students in a school.
Yes.
So if you're disciplined and you have the concern for the students, it means you are building a positive environment in your school. Secondly, practicing positive discipline is another way to prevent physical and emotional punishment or abuse in school and in the home.
Yeah, positive discipline is very important.
Very important. It's a school-wide.
Yeah.
It's not in a classroom. It's a school-wide. All the students, you create a positive
discipline.
It's a positive behavior. So that is, these two aspects is very important if you want to prevent the abuse.
And normally in classroom, we can see with a stick or with harsh words, the teachers are trying to create the discipline. That is not the way.
No, the teacher have to be very sensitive, very sensitive.
To their
and if you want to summarize, Dr. Elizabeth, we can say three things are very important. That is safe environment, opportunity to learn in a better way. And play and enjoy the childhood. This is the way how we can protect the child's right.
So I thought in this session, the teachers make to know that how they can be a good friend to a child.
So it is our teachers, you have a great responsibility on your soldier to promote the development of the children and to protect their rights.